still so much knowledge to be discovered out there about the racing car, so much in aerodynamics and construction, and he was always willing to just go beyond what was known, and sooner or later he was going to be on to something that was, you know, that had a specific advantage, and if you were on that ride, it was going to be a good ride. What?
Once the skirts were working, then I think you had a car, which I think Mario described it best as being painted to the road. I mean, it suddenly became another world, a world where the faster you went, the faster you could go. And you started to get into these prodigious braking and cornering forces that we see today, admittedly without skirts, but of course other developments have occurred.
Typically, the car brought protests from other teams who found themselves left behind by the Lotus radical design.
There is quite a lot of manoeuvring between the lawmakers and the adjudicating body and so on, but I think Formula One should be a sport which is not only a competition between drivers, but also between manufacturers of cars, and the objective should be to build better motor cars.
As always, Chapman's combination of innovation and motivation were at the heart of the team's success. 7.7.
He inspired people in many ways because his mind was so clear that he could come into a room full of people arguing about the solution to a particular problem, sweep away all the bullshit and go straight to the nub of it and sort it out, but then very often his solutions would be very exciting as well, and that would gender more excitement because there'd be people going around saying, God, he's not going to try that, is he? You never get away with that. And of course he would, and then that added to the legend and the atmosphere and the environment.
He was very much like the grand master. He used to come into the drawing office, come around all the drawing boards, and had the remarkable knack of just finding the little mistake you'd made you hadn't spotted. And within a few nanoseconds, it seemed, where you'd been struggling for hours, if not days, on a problem, he'd come in and be able to solve it within seconds.
If you added all the hours that Team Lotus Mechanics did over the years, compared with other teams, I would say they've probably done 50% more hours because they were doing more all-nighters, more things were changing during a Grand Prix in terms of setup or modification, because in a way the development process was often going on as well as racing the cars. He was very driven to succeed.
He's won this race.
We worked as and when required in a racing team. It wasn't a question of being an 8-till-5 job. We were a team of people supporting each other, and providing one could take the pressure and spend the time away from home and were physically fit and capable of working very long hours, you were okay.
When I go back and I try to bring back those memories, I mean, it just brings tears to your eyes.
Lotus, Andretti and the Type 79 secured the World Championship and returned in triumph to Norfolk.
Because Colin was such an innovator, many, many, many of his ideas flowed from Team Lotus, this tiny little organisation here in Norfolk, out into the motor industry in general. And as I said, there was a point where you could say there wasn't a car on the road in England which didn't owe something to him.
There's one question that's always asked about Lotus, and Hazel seemed to me to be the one who could answer it.
Now, the name Lotus, there are many stories about how the name came about. What's the definitive story? You tell me then.
He called his first car a Lotus for some reason or other, and it just stuck.
Why Lotus?
I don't know. I suppose he was a bit of a dreamer, like lots of us, and he dreamt about this island of paradise and just thought it was a good name and it stuck.
Things were never quite the same after Colin Chapman's death in 1982. By the 90s, the racing team's fortunes were in steady decline. And in 1995, it was all over for Team Lotus.
Lotus.